Hi, welcome to Visual Studio Toolbox. I'm your host, Robert Green.
I'm your other host, Leslie Richardson.
And I'm your guest, Phil Gipixi.
And we are now at the end of our, we called it a mini-series, but it's kind of...
It's pretty epic.
11 episodes in. It's a little bit more than mini. To our series on automated software testing, we have now reached the end.
Of the mega mini-series.
And today we are going to close by talking about UI testing of web apps with Microsoft Playwright.
Yeah. So we've talked all about testing code directly, right? Testing our data access layer through integration. And what we haven't touched on is how do we automate those UI tests?
Yeah.
Right? And that's also very important. I think in the first episode, we talked about, you know, where QA fits in. And where QA really provides, in my opinion, provides the most value is that overarching testing the system as a whole,
mm-hmm.
right? Is it behaving as the customer expects,
right?
So we can get all the Lego blocks working, but again, to try and get the Millennium Falcon or the submarine to work correctly, we need somebody with that big picture view.
Mm-hmm.
Playwright, and I'm not sure how long, you said you demoed it not too long ago.
Yeah.
I recently discovered it, so I don't know how long it's been around.
Well, at least since last year's build, so build 2021, did a demo of it on the Scott Hanselman keynote that was like office cringe style.
And that actually might be where I saw it the first time.
Yeah, it was really cool. I remember thinking it was pretty sweet.
Yeah, so if you think of Selenium or those different frameworks to automate tests, but those are mostly they're JavaScript frameworks, right? So Playwright allows you to use JavaScript as well and TypeScript, but it also has a C-sharp component,
mm-hmm.
right? So you can write C-sharp code to drive the test, which I'm a C-sharp developer, right? That's where I prefer to be. There's a couple things we have to get installed, though. So I have a little readme, or playwright.txt here in the GitHub repo,
mm-hmm.
and you gotta make sure Node.js and NPM are up to date.
Okay.
And once you do, then you just do NPM install Playwright. Now, I will let you know, this was a surprise to me. If you update the NuGet packages for Playwright in your project and don't rerun NPM install Playwright, everything will fail.
Oh, that sucks.
Because okay. the updated NuGet packages were expecting the Chromium browser extensions to be in a certain location, and I guess maybe they moved or something.
Okay.
Right, but once I reinstalled Playwright, everything was fine and just worked.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And that was something I discovered just before flying out here to do the series, so it made me a little nervous at the time.
So is Playwright only Chromium browser compatible? Or for people
maybe
using like Firefox or whatever?
No, I know you can use Firefox, I know you can use Chrome. I think it depends. If you want to use additional browsers, you have to install the extensions.
Okay,
I'm
so at least
sure
there
exactly
are those.
How to do that.
Yeah.
So I'm not an expert on UI testing. I will tell you, when we get into it, I'll tell you how we use it.
Okay.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
So once you have it installed, if you're just going to play with it, you can just have a normal console application, right, with program.cs, and bring in Microsoft Playwright.
Mm-hmm.
If you're going to write automated tests around it, you want to use something like XUnit to drive it, then guess what? We use our XUnit framework, right, or XUnit template, and then all we have to do is add Playwright into it.
Okay.
So let's look at how Playwright works, and it's your typical, and again, this is a very simple demo. You're going to create an instance, you're going to open a browser, you're going to look for certain things in the browser, whether it's by ID or CSS class, right, using CSS selectors. Then you can act on those things, you can do a click, you can type into a field, and then you can verify, like if it redirected, you verify. It's all the things you can do with web testing,
okay,
right? Which is great, but it's also one of the things, I know we were talking before we started the episode, that's one of the downfalls of web testing, is graphic designer comes in and starts prettying it up,
right?
Changing class names and things like that. Now my tests start failing, right? So they are more fragile than typical unit tests. But I still think it's a very important part.
Mm-hmm.
So what I'm going to do is we'll just step through, and do I have the right? Yep, right. Start up.
Yeah, and this is like a first impression for a lot of customers going to anyone's site and stuff.
Yeah.
The UI, how it's laid out, does it even work?
Right.
Like, it's going to change the fact whether I end up buying something or.
Well, and that's, you know, we have thousands of landing pages for different case types and case subtypes. And one of the things, you know, when I took over this job, you know, almost 3 years ago, I got really nervous going, how do we make sure all these things are up and running?
Yeah.
And so what we're doing is we're a combination of using some services in Azure, but we're also, we set up a function app that just goes out and pings all of our tests and said, is the logo here? And if it is, great, the site's up and running, everybody can rest assured, mm-hmm. right? Because mm-hmm. you typically are the last person to find out when something isn't up and running, right?
Right.
Yeah.
So we're going to create an instance of Playwright itself. Here we're launching you can't see it. Oh, I ran the whole thing because I hit F5 instead of step through. My bad. We'll do it again. Yes. Wow. You guys are watching me hit F10, right?
It's kind of hard to tell what you pressed, but
You have to take my word for it. Okay. Because I'm in a using. Sorry, that was me being an idiot. That was problem exists between the keyboard and the chair. I was in a using statement.
Oh, yeah.
And so let me actually get down to a non-using statement because, boy, I think I was new at development.
Fun fact, you can drag and drop your breakpoints.
You can, yes. All right. So what I have done is I've created an instance of a browser, and we'll put this over here. And we'll do this and this and hide that. So I'm going to go to google.com. I am now, you can barely see it, but right here it's asking me to log in. Mm-hmm. So what Google has done is popped up a new frame and says, you want to log in? Well, it's blocking my input until I respond to that. Mm. So I've actually handled that here. I say, oh, get me all the frames. And if I have more than one, that means I've got this login screen. And then I look for the word that says no thanks, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm. That's awesome.
So I'm looking for no thanks. Let me pin this back over here. And then I click it.
Yeah, cool.
So now I have just dismissed the, I'm going to force you to log in. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Conversely, if you wanted to log in, could you input either manually or could you hard code or not hard code? Yeah, essentially your authentication information.
Yes. You don't
want to. I mean, not that you want to.
Well, you don't really want to hard code your password. Yeah. She asked if you can, not if you should.
Not if you should.
Right?
Now, the option is there.
Okay, but let's look at it this way. What if you use Azure Key Vault to hold it, right? What if your testing was important? You could actually put your secrets in Azure Key Vault to then pull it down that way because we're just running C# code.
Exactly.
And then you could input it that way.
Yep.
Right?
And that's pretty sweet.
And I'm not a security expert, so I'm not telling you that's 100% secure. Let me put the disclaimer
in there. I feel like that's slightly better
right
than hard coding your password.
That's better than hard coding your password.
All right, so we're looking for something that has the ARIA label of search, and then we're going to fill it with the letters, well, the word Playwright. Okay, so when we do that, you see Playwright is right here. Type ahead is working with Google. And then I'm going to run and wait for navigation. Basically, what I'm doing is I'm saying, okay, go ahead and hit enter, right, mm-hmm. on this box, which then will pick up the enter. So let me run that right there. And then I want to find the XPath that contains Playwright fast and reliable end-to-end testing. So here's an example. If the Playwright homepage changed their H1, I'm not finding it anymore, mm-hmm. right?
Cool.
So then I'm like, okay, click that. Now I'm on the Playwright page. Now I'm looking for the text get started right here.
Mm-hmm.
Now I'm going to click it.
Which is case insensitive.
Case insensitive.
Nice.
Right? Now I'm on the installation page. I'm going to take a screenshot.
Mm.
The path is here. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So now I have a screenshot. I do a read line because I'm really old school. I know Visual Studio will say, do you want to exit the program? But I can't get away from doing the read line at the end of a console app. And then if I look, here is my snapshot of the page.
Okay. Right?
Pretty sweet.
So that's how to run it. Let's talk about how we make a test out of it, right? So let's go, and it's the same code, just a little different flavor. And oh, by the way, there's an update to Visual Studio. Should I install it now?
Sure, why not?
Why not?
Yeah. Okay. I did earlier. This is a pretty quick one.
All right, so this is really the same, not really the same, because it is the same code with a few twists put in. So here's my fact. Verify Google search for Playwright. So this is the same, this is the same. I'm navigating, mm-hmm. I'm dismissing my sign in, I'm awaiting for the fill, but then I get down to here and I'm asserting that's the page that I got navigated to, right? And we've got all kind of, we can, so this is page.url, I can find different options, right? Then I click that and then I assert that the page URL is this.
Nice.
So I didn't go deep in this demo, right? But again, if you're doing a health check, you go, okay, is this image here? Is this label here? Great, go away. If it's much more involved, and you can record, I haven't done that, but you could actually set recordings up to replay.
Which actually is a way of in many cases, getting around the fact that the page may change. I just want to make sure that when I click getting started, I go to the getting started page. Whatever's on that page, I got nothing to do with.
Right.
My tests are not going to fail just because you changed that page. You might want to do some smoke testy type thing, but as long as I go to that page, then my UI test passes because that page could change over and over and over again.
Right.
Right.
And I know some people with a lot of UI testing experience, and they're probably throwing things at the computer right now because I said I don't do a lot of it. It really is a very, very distinct skill that I don't have. And if you've got, and also I don't have full-time QA on my staff, right? Mm-hmm. I have a development team. We also do QA. We also do requirements. It's a true, development or delivery team, as I like to call it. But if you've got a big enough organization, and I've consulted in some where they do have QA departments, and they have very complicated scripts because maybe it's not changing, right? We're now released, and we just want to make sure, your large grocery store, and if you navigate to search for bananas, does it come up with where the bananas are located and if they're in stock and mm-hmm. things like that, right? So I'm not downplaying it. It's just we've got a small enough organization that I had to make decisions as to what I'm testing, and I'm going with the unit testing and the integration testing over the UI testing, except, of course, for the smoke test.
Yeah.
But I've played with Selenium in the past. I never really got it, right, because I'm not heavy into JavaScript. I write just enough JavaScript to get by. Mm-hmm. But I really, really like Playwright. It's all C# based, right? It all made sense to me.
Right.
It's all got, I have IntelliSense. Oh, page dot. Oh, click async, right? And then, it actually prompts you what page or what do you want to click.
But if you did nothing more than check for busted links, right? If that's all you did with this, because you've got a page that's been up for a while, and once a week you can run this, or once every X number of days or whatever, run a bunch of scripts that go to a page, click on all the links, just to see what links have broken.
Yeah.
That would be an awesome use of this, right? You write it once, and then you just fire it off on a regular basis. And once a week, you get a report. All the links are working. Or, guess what? These three links are broken.
Yeah, because you wouldn't.
I don't know when. Doesn't matter when. But right now, they're not working. Go fix them.
Yeah, because you wouldn't even have to hard code the links, right? You just say, get me all the links mm-hmm. on the page, and you loop through the collection.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So that would be a good use of this as well.
Yeah.
So you don't have to go into full-blown UI testing of every single text box and drop down and whatnot. If you did nothing more than this, that's pretty useful.
Well, and again, it's the right tool for the right job. Mm-hmm. Like, what do you need in your organization,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
We need to know that our hundreds and probably thousands of landing pages are up, right? It's easy to tell when they are up because we're getting leads, we're getting information, right? But if they're not up, or if we're not getting data from a particular landing page, is that because it's down or because nobody's hit it?
Right.
Now a human has to go look, mm-hmm. right?
And you can be looking at your, looking at your numbers or how many people are, or like what's the traffic like from one page to the next. If no mm-hmm. one's on going to a specific page that you want people to go to, it's like, is it because we didn't market it well or something, or is it because there's some disconnect somewhere? Yeah.
So. Can you, as part of this, detect how long it took pages to load?
Yes. Do I have an example to show you? No, but I remember when I was digging into this.
Because that would also be a very interesting automated test to run on a regular basis. Just load click on every single link, load every single page, and tell me which ones take more than 5 seconds to load, because that could be why no one responds on that page, because it doesn't load in a in a useful amount of time.
That's true. I presume so.
Okay.
I mean, if nothing else, right, you put a timer here.
Yeah.
You put a timer here.
Right.
And you compare the difference.
Sure.
But if I recall correctly, there was something built into the framework that actually did that for you.
Mm-hmm. And then you could presumably, as part of your test, assert that the page took less than 5 seconds to load.
Oh,
and if it doesn't, the test fails. You do something like that.
Well, you get a whole response. So I'm going to say yes, there's something built in. I'm not going to waste camera time right now digging through IntelliSense.
Okay.
But yeah, I mean, you get all kinds of properties coming off that response. So just like you can with an API request, I presume that you can also do that with the UI request. Yeah.
Cool.
So that's what I got.
That's nice. All right.
Sweet.
So that wraps up our series on
the
automated
mini
software.
The mega
testing.
Mini series on automated software testing.
Hope you enjoyed that. Thanks for watching start to finish, which hopefully you did.
Yeah, any concluding thoughts before we wrap up?
You know, it's really important to know that your code is doing what you expect it to, right? And if you can, if you're spending all your time hitting F5 and stepping through code, you're not delivering new features or new capabilities to your customer, whether it's internal or external. So the more you can automate this, the more you can feel comfortable with making changes, you know, the better your life's going to be. It's quality of life, right? It's not just quality of code, it's quality of life, because you're not going to be, you're not going to get that call at 4 o'clock in the morning saying the site's down,
right?
You know, if it's something that you could have tested.
Yep.
So I guess that's really, I'll get off my soapbox now.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for being here.
And that was fun.
Thanks.
Yeah, and it's also exciting that all this code that we've been doing for 11 some episodes is going to be available for anyone in the show notes. Right?
Yeah, and it will probably be, I can actually show a teaser. So if I go to github.com and I go to Schematic, which is me. You can't see right now because I want to get it loaded first and I'll bring it over. And I go to software testing. Look at that.
This
is where it's going to be, right there.
Here we go.
Awesome.
So schematic.com, or github.com, schematic, as in snow ski, paramedic, and then software testing. And right now you can see it's empty because I only created it, but I'll be checking in shortly, probably from the airport. And we'll get all the code out there.
Excellent.
Certainly by the time these shows are live.
So by the time you're watching this, it should be filled.
Yeah,
it will be filled.
It will be.
All right.
Awesome.
Cool.
And you're also on Twitter, right? Or like, how
I am on Twitter. I'm on Schematic at Twitter.
Awesome.
Schematic at Outlook.com. Pretty much I'm Schematic anywhere. Schematic.com. And that's ski as in snow ski. Medic as in paramedic. You know what? We'll do the old Scott Hanselman trick. And we'll bring up Notepad. And we'll bring it over here, and we'll type schematic in really big letters.
All right.
Awesome.
So that's GitHub, that's Twitter, that's LinkedIn, that's Facebook. I am on Instagram now. I have no idea what my handle is because I just joined. But yeah, that's the best way to get a hold of me.
Excellent.
Great.
All right. That's it.
That's a wrap.
See you next time on Visual Studio Toolbox.
Bye. Thanks for watching.